Welcome to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight on this Wednesday, July 15th, 2015. Day one of Jade Helm. We're going to be watching that very closely. We've got some reports on that coming up. Of course, we're also going to be talking about this new video from Planned Parenthood. We're going to be talking about the deal with Iran, Obama's deal with Iran. People are weighing in on both sides of that. We've got the neocons like Dick Cheney furious about it. But then, of course, we've got this is a deal that has actually been put together by Obama. I don't know whose side to take. I really don't have a dog in this fight. So I'm going to go back and look at this in historical context. We're going to look at this in terms of what was actually done in terms of lifting the sanctions. Will that make a difference or not one way or the other? So we're going to talk about that a little bit. Of course, Alex Jones is going to be joining us later in the program. He's now working on a big special report. He's going to be back and later on in the program. We're also going to have as a guest with us today, Dr. Group. Before we do, I want to go over some of the news that's here. We've got a big news day today. I don't want to go into depth on those stories that I just mentioned, but some of these smaller stories, I thought this was kind of interesting. At the same time, we've got Janet Yellen, top of the Drudge Report, kind of warning Congress to lay off of the Federal Reserve. Don't put any regulations on me. We've got a Santa Cruz County that votes to cease doing business with five too-big-to-fail megabanks. And, of course, what they do in this letter is they cite the involvement of Citigroup, J.P. Morgan Chase, Barclays, Royal Bank of Scotland, UBS. They leave out, for some reason, HSBC. But they talk about how they have been found guilty of rigging markets, the LIBOR markets. Have they been found guilty by the Justice Department? Of course, Eric Holder's Justice Department didn't send anybody to jail. He didn't suspend anybody's charters. He gave them fairly small fines. So at least at this local level, and I point out this story, even though it's a small story, because I think we have to understand what's going on globally, but we have to act locally. That's what the globalists have been saying for a long time to their grassroots people. Act locally, but think globally. Yeah, we need to do the same thing. We need to understand the global conspiracy for government. We need to understand who the global corporations are behind this global government, and we need to start shutting them down at the local level. Look at this from the Hill. We have taxpayers who are going to be paying $4 million for the CEOs of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. Do you remember the bubble and the burst of the real estate bubble? Part of that was because of large incentives, bonuses given to the CEOs of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac to look the other way, to extend loans to people who were not qualified for these loans. Now they want to give them salary increases of $150,000 a year, go from $600,000 to $750,000 because, you know, they just never can get enough money to those guys. At the same time, what do we get in the United States? Well, we're getting the iron fist everywhere. We've got California, who just recently passed the SB 277 bill that mandated vaccines for children in order to get an education. The only exception for the time being is homeschooling. You can't put them even in a private school without getting them vaccinated with the vaccines that the government demands on the schedule that the government demands. No exceptions for anyone. So they just got that passed. And you know what? If you don't stop tyranny, they just keep coming at you. So now they're coming again with a bill to make adults who are working in any kind of rest home or adult care facility to make it a legal requirement. It'll be a criminal offense as well as taking the license of the organization if they don't get vaccinated. Now, that went up for a hearing last night. We had that article up on Infowars.com. I don't know the result of that hearing last night, if that is moving forward or not, but that is something people need to keep a close eye on. If it doesn't move forward, I can tell you that is the direction. Going down into medical tyranny is the direction that we are going. And at the same time, we see judges at the U.S. Circuit Court of Appeal demanding that nuns are now going to have to pay for abortion-causing drugs. Nuns. I mean, this is the insanity. This is crony capitalism writ large. This is what Obamacare is about. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this Wednesday, July 15th, 2015. Of course, this is day one of Jade Helm. It was about a week ago that the Washington Post did a story. Jade Helm 15, heavily scrutinized military exercise to open without media access. That's exactly a week ago, July 8th. Actually, a week before that, they reprinted a mocking article that had been circulated a couple of months ago, making fun of the people in Bastrop, Texas, for being concerned and wanting to know what their government is. I mean, why should the slaves ever question what our masters tell us? And of course, these are the guys who want to be our masters. They want to master the human domain. That includes us, especially us. That's where they're training here. So a week before, they had this mocking article saying, the Americans are coming. The Americans are coming. They're invading Texas. That was never our concern. And we've made this clear from the very beginning. We didn't think this was going to be the onset of martial law. If that was ever the plan. Of course, that's not going to be the case now because it's widely understood what's going on with Jade Helm. But now we saw about a week ago, Washington Post actually talking about how there wasn't going to be any media access. They said embedded reporters will not be permitted at any point during the exercise. This is from Lieutenant Colonel Mark Lastoria, same guy who went to Bastrop. The Washington Post pointed out that, for several times, they have requested access to observe Jade Helm. They said they made the case to the military that firsthand coverage would help to explain the mission. Yeah, see, if you don't have anything to hide, like these multinational treaties that are being done in secret, like pretty much everything our government is being doing in secret, we keep hearing these assurances that, you know, these treaties that we're doing, they're going to be great for you. You're going to win. That's what the American politicians tell the Americans. The European politicians tell the Europeans they're going to win in these trade agreements. But they won't show us the trade agreement. They tell us, don't worry, we're not going to give monopolies to Monsanto or the big pharmaceutical companies. But just trust us. We can't show you the agreement right now. They can't show us what's going on. It was a year ago that the military was meeting in the Pentagon. And one lady stood up there that was an officer. She stood up to the guy who was the head of the press corps, I think. I don't remember what his exact title was, but she said, nobody believes us. They say that we're just giving them mindless propaganda. How do we get through that? And he goes, yeah, it's a problem because, you know, we got Drudge out there and we got all these different alternative media and the internet. And I mean, these people are questioning what we do and pointing out when we lie to people. So the Washington Post is telling them, hey, let's just have firsthand media coverage. You can shut down all the speculation about what you're doing, which they call conspiracy theories. Okay, if you investigate, if you question the official story, that's always called a conspiracy theory. Come on, can we move on past that? That was something that was created by the CIA 50 years ago after the Kennedy assassination to shut down any questioning of the ridiculous official story at that point in time. And they've used it to try to cover up every ridiculous lie they've told us since then. We're not supposed to investigate. We're not supposed to question. That's precisely what an investigator does for a police department. Where they're investigating murder or some other crime, they always come up with plausible scenarios. Who benefits from this? What can we learn about this? They try to uncover facts. They try to put together stuff because nobody comes out and says, well, this is what happens. And of course, our government doesn't operate in a transparent mode anymore. So the Washington Post says, hey, give us firsthand media coverage. We could shut down the speculation. But Lastoria said, this is what the Washington Post says. Lastoria told us it's not possible to allow a journalist to travel with special operation forces in the field. He cited the isolated nature of the mission and the need to protect the identities of the special force troops. But then they point out, well, the military has granted access to special operation training in the past. They said in one recent example, a journalist observed the exercise Robin Sage in North Carolina. Remember when they talked about that? Remember when we said, hey, what are you doing here? They said, we do this stuff all the time. We do Robin Sage every year in North Carolina. And of course, you know, they tell us it's the same thing. Well, it's not the same thing. They allow journalism coverage in Robin Sage in North Carolina. They do Robin Sage every year. They don't do this particular exercise, and they go on with this. They say the exercise was considered to be a final test for Green Beret soldiers in training. It calls for them to work through a scenario in which they organize a guerrilla force to overthrow the government of the fictional nation of Pineland. There's another difference between Jade Helm and Robin Sage. As Louis Gohmert pointed out, he had been in the military for a long time. I think he retired as a captain. He said, we always had fictional areas that we went against. We trained in military bases, not outside of the military bases amongst the civilian population. But of course, this is an exercise that doesn't have a fictional basis. That's one of the things that he was concerned about. One of the things we're concerned about. Look, we don't need the military conducting exercises outside of military bases. We don't need the military training to take over civilian populations outside of the military bases. Understand that when the military does these training exercises, and we're seeing these things happening all along, they come up to intimidate Russia in the Ukraine, or what they do, military training exercises in the Mediterranean. They go into the Ukraine. They do these various exercises. Both Russia and the U.S. do this. They've always done this. Go right up close to where they're going to be fighting, do the training. It's a method of intimidation. Okay. It's also a method of intimidation. So at one point, I remember this interview with Vladimir Putin. We've played it on InfoWars before, where some guy's telling him, hey, these exercises that are being done on the border of your country, they're not directed at you. And when the translator ran that through, Putin looked at him and just laughed for about 20 seconds. Come on. We know the same thing. We've seen these exercises being built up year after year after year. We saw them marching people out in the dead of night in Fort Lauderdale. They typically don't tell people that, you know, we see this being this kind of training going on when it was happening in L.A. They talked to someone. He says, well, you know, you train the way you're going to fight. Where are you going to fight? If you're going to fight in the mountains, you train in the mountains. If you're going to do it in the desert, you do it in the desert. If you're going to train in American cities, you train in American cities with the police. Of course, you know, we don't need this kind of training. We don't need special forces operating as boots on the ground for the NSA. That's what they've put themselves out there for. That's what McRaven was shopping himself out for. That's the thing that concerns me the most, okay? That we would have the military putting themselves out there as boots on the ground for the NSA. And if you understand what human domain analytics is about, if you understand what mastering the human domain is about, that was the keynote title, the title of the keynote speech at the U.S. Geospatial Intelligence Foundation a couple of years ago. What they're doing is they're collecting biometrics on you, not just the fingerprints and everything. And of course, we got another article here about how the government has just lost 21 million fingerprints, have been hacked for that, after losing millions and millions of Social Security data, losing their employees' data. I mean, really? Are we supposed to trust these people? But the scariest thing about this is that they're taking this biometric information, they're combining it with activity-based intelligence so that they can track everywhere you go. That becomes the ultimate biometric. That was a report that we did that Rob Jacobson put together. Jakari Jackson narrated that just a couple of weeks ago, talking about how the ultimate biometric is your activity-based intelligence. Who you know, where you go, when you go. And that's not our quote. That's not our summary. That's the summary of IBM's man who works in this field. This is the coming area, the up-and-coming area of intelligence. It's been there for a long time. It's been a U.S. Geospatial Intelligence Group for at least 15 years. That's when James Clapper was put in charge of it. It predates that. It's a massive part of the military-industrial complex, and the Special Forces people, Admiral McRaven, when he was there as commander, was looking for increased involvement with Special Forces. We should be very concerned that a government that wants to track us everywhere we go, know everything about us, denies everything, denies us knowing anything about them. We should be very concerned when they start combining with troops, labeling our states, our real areas, as enemy areas, and create an exercise that's going to last for a couple of months. This is an intelligence gathering operation. It began when people pushed back against it. They wanted to mark down who's for them and who's against them. Well, put me down as against this. I have no intimidation about saying that. Put me down as against a militarized police state. A standing army is a danger to this republic. And it is no better example of this than military exercises that say they're going to be moving amongst the population, trying to keep from being detected. It's unconventional warfare. Unconventional warfare doesn't mean it's just a little bit different from what they've done before. It's a very specific term. This is what special forces do. They go in, they identify who in the government they can work with, who is going to be opposed to them, so they know who to take down, who to reward, who to do their dirty work. It's a PSYOP operation. That's also part of unconventional warfare. But they're combining this with geospatial intelligence, biometric information. This is pre-crime profiling. You should be very concerned about this. Very concerned. Let me give you an example. When you look at police pre-crime profiling, that it's being passed over to artificial intelligence, as we're seeing increasingly. A good example of how this can go wrong, and it already has, as they're developing the software. They have all these cameras watching people. They have so many cameras, they can't hire enough people to watch us, to look at those cameras. Same problem that the East German Stasi government had, right? So what's the solution? Well, now they've got computers that they can program, and they can give them these algorithms. So here's an example. One of these tests, they were looking at a guy who was standing next to his car for a while. And then the camera and the AI noticed that this guy who was standing next to this camera for a little bit of time, all of a sudden kneels down and disappears. Ah, they say, this looks like a car theft. So they dispatch 911. The guy was changing his tire. But of course, in this environment, where the police are being trained by the federal government to shoot first and don't even ask any questions, that could wind up getting someone killed. We need to understand what our founder said, what Madison said. A standing army is a danger to the Republic. The means of defense abroad have always become the tools of tyranny at home. Stay with us. When we come back, we're going to talk about what's going on with Planned Parenthood, this new video that was released, and the pushback against it. We'll be right back. Alex Jones will be joining us later in the show. He's working on a big story right now, but he'll be in studio with us. I want to go to a report that Joe Biggs shot yesterday about the beginning of Jade Helm. Let's run that report.
Joe Biggs here with Infowars.com. Now we are less than 24 hours away from Operation Jade Helm 1-5 being conducted. Now, there's a lot of things I want to talk about. The fact that the mainstream media continuously tries to demonize Infowars.com on its coverage of Jade Helm.
Well, conspiracy theories are running wild tonight about the Army's plan for a multi-state training exercise this summer called Jade Helm 15.
Texas will be simulated hostile territory. Well, that hostile characterization didn't sit well with a far-right radio host in Austin who told his listeners that he had access to the secret document that details a federal takeover in Texas.
The fact that so many Americans really just don't even trust the government since the Obama administration has been in place. And it has nothing to do with race. We don't like Bush either. But things have really gotten bad since he has been the president of the United States. And like Ted Cruz said, there's nothing wrong with people questioning the government. That is our right as Americans. We're supposed to question the government because I'll tell you what, our government will question us all the time. So we have to flip that around on them and try and find out what's going on and expose the truth. Now, there's a number of things that the mainstream media has been doing. They say that we try to fearmonger, that we're basically giving birth to this paranoid group of Americans about Jade Helm, when in fact they do the exact same stuff, except even worse because they have a much larger following. Fox News, CNN, millions and millions of people all around the world watch these places. And in the days coming up to the 4th of July weekend, what did they do? They said there was going to be an imminent attack by ISIS on the 4th of July weekend. That's fear-mongering. They had no proof of that happening whatsoever. And the 4th of July came, and nothing happened. You hear nothing from the entire populace of Americans complaining, hey, why are you guys pushing this? Why are you doing this? But I guarantee you, when Jade Helm comes and goes, and nothing happened, the same thing's going to happen to us. They're going to demonize us again, going, oh my God, look at these kooky tinfoil hat people that said that there was going to be an overthrow of the government and that they were going to take your guns and nothing happened. Oh my God. That's ridiculous because they're doing the exact same stuff. They fear monger more than anybody. Every time you turn on one of those TV shows, it's the most depressing thing in the world. And all we're trying to do is look at these documents and slides and go, hey, this needs to be questioned. This needs to be looked at. And we're not the only people who think that, because Governor Greg Abbott of Texas thinks the exact same thing. He's listened to his constituents and is now going to have the Texas State Guard monitoring the Jade Helm 1-5 exercises. You have Chuck Norris coming out saying, hey, if you don't know about Jade Helm, you should. There's a lot of people around the world who are concerned about it, and all eyes are going to be on Texas, Utah, Southern California, and Florida over the next 2 months to see whether or not there's a takeover or if nothing happens. But there's one thing I can tell you will happen, a conditioning of the people. And that's what we've said since day one. This will be used as a tool to condition the American public to seeing military roaming up and down the streets in Humvees, helicopters flying at night, exercises being conducted. Now, someone inside Special Ops saying that there will be no media access granted to any type of news agencies out there to cover this. But time and time again over the past, media has been allowed to go cover these events. Now, what were they thinking when they released this statement? This adds further speculation to what's going on with Jade Helm. We've already caught the architects of Jade Helm in a lie numerous times. They said that the people, the private landowners, came to special operations and requested that their land be used for an operation that they didn't even know existed. When in fact, SOCOM came out there, knocked on their door and said, hey, can we use your land and we're going to give you money? They denied giving money, but the mayor of Big Spring, Texas came out and said, in fact, that the government approached them and also was giving them money. So over the next 2 months, we're going to be out here covering these stories. We're going to try to go to different locations across Texas, maybe some of the other states as well, to bring you guys up-to-date information. But I want to ask a favor from each and every single one of you out there watching this video right now. If you live in one of these areas where these missions will be conducted, please get off the couch, go out, grab your camera, go rent a camera, get a cheap little Polaroid, something, take pictures, and email us at showtips@infowars.com with these videos so you can help us get this information out to the people who want to see it. So once again, thank you for watching this video. My name is Joe Biggs with infowars.com.
Absolutely, folks. This is your country, too. So if you see something, show something. Give it to us, put it up on YouTube, send us a link. We need to get this information out there. It's difficult sometimes to distinguish between something that is suspicious and something that is routine military movement because we have so much military in this country. Stay with us. When we come back, we're going to talk about this Washington Post story on Planned Parenthood. Yeah, this is ultimately, folks, this is not about pro-choice. This is not about the right to privacy. Can we even hear them say those ridiculous words anymore when they take away your right to make decisions, informed consent about what's injected into your body? They want to talk about pro-choice. They want to talk about a right to privacy when we've got a government that spies and maps out everything that we do. When they take away our informed consent on every basis. And of course, we've got another bill before California legislature. Now that they got informed consent removed from parents for their children in order to get an education, now they're going to extend it to nursing homes. And of course, we've talked to nurses against mandatory vaccines. This has been going on for quite some time through intimidation to nurses and healthcare workers in hospitals. Now they're going to make a crime out of it in California. And of course, and we interviewed her. One of the things that she pointed out to us was that they knew that when they gave these vaccines to premature, low birth weight babies, they knew it was going to require intubation. It was going to create respiratory emergencies for these children, and yet they did it anyway. They said, get the stuff ready. We're about to vaccinate these kids. And they knew they couldn't handle it, but they did it anyway. That's where we are, folks. And oh, by the way, in case you thought that was a conspiracy theory or you didn't believe her when she said that, within about a month, she found a study where the Journal of the AMA actually admitted that they had done a long-term study of several thousand children and had seen exactly that and refused to stop doing it. Now, yesterday we had this video that was broken by an undercover research, a group that was looking at Planned Parenthood. Of course, we have the doctor. And let's understand, folks, we need to get over this idea that just because somebody has an MD degree does not make them trustworthy, does not make them ethical, okay? They can be corrupted like anybody else. You've got good doctors, you've got bad doctors. You've got good cops, you've got bad cops. You've got good people in the military, you've got bad people in the military, okay? That's why we have to have a system that doesn't operate on blind trust of authority. The doctors can be corrupted. We've seen many, many incidents of this. We've had doctors who did the Tuskegee experiment. We've got doctors who are working with the CIA doing torture in Gitmo. Over and over again, we see this in America. We don't have to go to Nazi Germany to point it out. But of course, we had Josef Mengele doing experiments on people in Nazi war camps, saying that this is for the greater good. We're going to learn things about the human body by experimenting on these people without their consent. And that's going to help the rest of us, really. Okay, so now we've got this Planned Parenthood doctor, and she's not just any doctor. Dr. Deborah Nucatola. She is Planned Parenthood Federation of America. That's the overreaching group that franchises us out, I guess. She's the senior director for them of medical services, and they did an undercover video of her, and she is monologuing like a supervillain. And one of the things that is most annoying and frustrating about this, and just, I don't even know, it's just exasperating to see her and her callous, cavalier attitude munching away in this restaurant while she's talking about how she's going to chop up body parts a la carte. Pre-orders on these body parts. And we're going to talk about what she had to say. But first, this is the way the mainstream media spun it back. They wouldn't report it for the first part of the day. They waited until the very end of the day till they could come up with a spin on it. Well, one of the things that they did was when they first came out, the headline was, undercover video shows Planned Parenthood executives discussing, I'm so disgusted, shows Planned Parenthood executive discussing organ harvesting. That was the first headline from the Washington Post. Then they changed it and said, no, she's not discussing organ harvesting. She's discussing fetal organs used for research. Look, if that was true, it would simply include the, and I'm sure it is true. I'm sure they do use it for research, among other things. Whatever they're doing with it, it's an indictment of the entire medical community, the entire medical community that is now clamoring across the country to force us to take whatever they tell us that we have to take, to remove our informed consent for vaccines as they remove any legal liability from the pharmaceutical companies that make something and call it a vaccine. As John Rappaport said when he was on last Friday, they can do genetic experimentation. They can do things that will genetically modify your DNA, and they can call that a vaccine. They can call anything that they inject into you a vaccine, in which case they've been given legal immunity since 1986. So they have every financial incentive to, A, do no testing to make sure that this is safe, and B, do as much of it as they can. But this is what Washington Post says about this in terms of the way they spin it. They changed the headline from organ harvesting to research. Here's some good news in here. I really want to thank Governor Greg Abbott. I am constantly pleasantly surprised at what this man has done since he's been in office a short time. He tweeted this out yesterday, and this is in the article as well. This is an article that's up on Infowars.com. Greg Abbott tweeted out last night, he said, I already sued Planned Parenthood for Medicaid fraud. Now Texas will look into these organ harvesting claims. Of course, it wasn't just the Washington Post. It was CNN. It was Newsweek. It was the New York Times. It was all the mainstream media coming back and saying, move along. There's nothing to see here. This is a conspiracy theory. This is the way CNN puts it. They say it is a purported video. No, it's an actual video. You can see it. You can see it on our site. You can see it on the internet. I would suggest that you watch it because this is the way they push back on it. They say the video seemingly shows a member of the conservative Manhattan Institute's Center for Medical Progress claiming to be a startup biotech firm attempting to buy human fetal tissue for medical research. Planned Parenthood dismissed the video, calling it highly edited. No, it's not highly edited, and it's not a purported video. It's for real. And let me read you some of the stuff that's there, and I'll let the guys play this as a B-roll in the background for people who are watching this, but it's difficult to hear it on the radio. It is a hidden camera that's done at a lunch meeting, and they have it subtitled with large subtitles so you can see that. And by the way, anybody that wants to say that it is heavily edited, the Center for... let's see, what is the name of this organization? Center for Medical Progress, that did the investigation. They put out a 60-page transcript, so you can see everything there, okay? But what they have her saying and these long monologues that she's got are damning enough. Let me read some of this to you. They ask her, how much of a difference can this actually make? You know, if I kind of know what it's expected or we know what we need. So this is what I'm saying. This is the pre-order your body parts a la carte. And she says, well, if I know what's expected, that makes a huge difference. I'd say a lot of people want liver, and for that reason, most providers will do this case under ultrasound guidance so they'll know where they're putting their forceps. This kind of rate-limiting step of the procedure is Calvarium. Calvarium is the head, basically the biggest part. You know, like Christ was crucified in Calvary, the place of the skull. The Calvarium is the Latin for the skull. So she says, yeah, we use the skull. We try to do that. But, you know, we want to maintain the chest cavity area is what she's saying. Now, here's what she said. Going back to her exact quotes. She says, and with the Calvarium in general, some people will actually try to change the presentation so that it's not vertex. Okay. Now, understand, and this is their comment in the video when they say heavily edited. What they did was they added commentary. They stopped it at that point. They let it go a little bit. She says, so you start from a breech presentation. In other words, we don't want it to come from a vertex presentation. So we find it useful in order to harvest these organs. We find it useful to manipulate the baby into a breech position for birth. And so then they put up on the video, they say, well, using ultrasound guidance to manipulate the fetus from vertex to breech orientation before intact extraction is the hallmark of the illegal partial birth abortion procedure. And they say, of course, the sale and purchase of human fetal tissue is a federal felony punishable by up to 10 years in prison and a fine of $500,000. Now, this doctor knows this. She knows that what they're doing is illegal, and she responds to that. She says, well, you know, partial birth abortion is illegal. We know that. But, she says, laws are open to interpretation. Actually, they're open to prevarication, aren't they, doctor? To do whatever you want. Now, understand that, as I pointed out, moving the child into a breech position is the hallmark of partial birth abortion. As I've said before, I never really paid any attention to abortion. We were fortunate, my wife and I, we were never in a situation where we had to make that decision. And I feel very bad for people who have had to make that decision. I never really approached this from any perspective other than, let's say, a libertarian perspective, where it's like, I don't want government making decisions for me. I'll decide for myself. I really hadn't thought this through until I ran for Congress. And then I had people asking me, because partial birth abortion had just come out at that point in time, asking me what my position was on it. And I'd never heard of partial birth abortion. So I was curious and looked it up. Now, what they do is they take a baby that is viable, that is near to full term. They turn the baby around. They cause the mother to have a breech birth. And then before the baby is fully out of the mother, they murder it. They murder it. That is what this is. That's why it is illegal. But that is what they're doing so that they can preserve the tissues. They want to get the extremities. They want to make sure they get all the organs that are in the thoracic area. So they're manipulating it as a partial birth abortion. They are taking these parts as pre-order. Tell us what you want. We'll get it a la carte for you, okay? She says, at the national office, this is the doctor talking again from Planned Parenthood. She says, at the national office, we have a litigation and law department which just really doesn't want us to be in the middle right now on this issue. Yeah, I bet they don't. But they are. Thanks to the work of the people who did that undercover video, and that is, again, the Center for Medical Progress. This is the first, they say, of three videos that are going to be released. They say this was a nearly three-year-long investigation. It's part of a documentary that is going to show what is going on with this. Now, one of the things that Planned Parenthood said was, in their excuses, they say, well, patients sometimes want to donate tissue to scientific research. If you watch this video, and I suggest you watch it, if you can stand it, it'll probably get you very upset. It should get you very upset unless your conscience has been seared with a hot iron. If you look at this, there's nothing in there about talking to patients about donating tissue. They're saying, you tell us what you want, we'll get it. Okay? They're not informing the patients. They're also not looking after the patient's best interest when they create a breech birth. This is something that is an indictment not only of Planned Parenthood. This is an indictment of our legal system. It's an indictment of our society. It's an indictment of medical research in general that they would do something like this. I don't care if STEM research is the one that's making money. They're playing a shell game saying, oh, we're not making any money off of this. Baloney. We know exactly what's going on with this, and we know that there's a whole chain of people who are making money off of this. And this is an indictment, as I said, of everything in this country. We need to shut this down. This is just, I just don't have words for it. Interesting that as this was all going on yesterday, somebody decided that they would hack Scott Walker's website, readyforwalker.com. I don't know. This is a story that came out on Tuesday. I don't know if they did it on Monday or not, but they hacked readyforwalker.com and redirected it to Planned Parenthood. Oh, great guys, aren't they? So we've got a lot of candidates who are reacting to this. But I want to see the public reacting to this. I want people to take a look at this. I want you to look at it for yourself. I want you to educate others, educate yourself. Many people have sat on the sidelines for decades, as I did, not understanding what was involved in this. Many people who had an abortion did not understand what was involved in this. I understand that. We all understand that. We all do things in our life we regret. We need to stop, though. We need to take a close look at what's going on. I tell you, one of the other things that bothers me, this is another article that's in the news today. Man left paralyzed after militarized police fill him with bullet holes because he's got 8 ounces of weed. This is a guy who's sitting in his chair playing Xbox when he gets a SWAT raid and he is shot multiple times and paralyzed. The war on drugs. Another piece of insanity in our society. Listen, with all the stuff going on about Chapo? I don't know. Anyway, this guy that Donald Trump is talking about so much, wouldn't it be interesting if Donald Trump would talk about how this guy became a billionaire in the drug trade? You know how he became a billionaire? You know why he's such a big guy? Because of our war on drugs, because of prohibition. It made him a made man like Al Capone. Prohibition doesn't work. It paralyzes people who are playing video games in their home and not bothering anybody. Stay with us. We'll be right back. We're going to talk about Iran as well. Alex Jones is going to be joining us later in the show, live in studio. He's working on a big story, but he will be with us later in the show. Now, this hour of the Alex Jones Show has been made possible by our Made in 1776 clothing line that you can find at InfoWarsStore.com. Of course, everything there is made in America. We have, for a limited time only, our Moulin Labe belt buckles. You can get them at 25% off. A great time to have that with everything that's going on, the struggle of Greek people against the bankers in Europe. It's a good time to have Moulin Labe. Of course, it has implications for us as well. You can get that at 25% off. You can support people who are making products in the United States. It is a win-win-win because you can support InfoWars as well and have a conversation starter where you can start to talk to people about the issues that really matter, about freedom, about liberty. We also, besides the belt buckles, we have Save America t-shirts. We have a Moulin Labe hoodie and many other things. You can find all that at InfoWarsStore.com. Click on the Made in 1776 label on the left-hand side. In the last segment, we were talking about, of course, the Mexican drug lord who's just escaped from prison, the multi-billionaire who just escaped from prison. And I said, you know, with all the talk that we have, and of course, there's a lot of points to be made about the open border, the absurdity of the situation, the danger of the situation that criminals and drug cartels can easily flow through the border. How did these drug cartels come into existence, though? Let's not give that part of the story a pass. What made this guy? As I said just before we went to break, what created him, what made him a billionaire is the war on drugs. What created the drug cartels that are so violent, over 30,000 people, I don't know what the exact total is, in Mexico, have died, brutally died. I mean, this drug cartel that he's head of, the Sinaloa cartel, they had their money laundered by HSBC. They were producing ISIS-style videos where they're chopping people's heads off with chainsaws. But of course, HSBC, Eric Holder's former client, was given pretty much a pass for laundering money. They even had their own teller window there. So we can't talk about the origins or the real problem of the violence, which is the drug trade, drug prohibition, which gives a monopoly to these criminals. No, we can't talk about that. We can only talk about the open borders. The open borders and the violence coming across the open borders, you understand, is a symptom of the problem. It is not the origin of the problem. And it is the drug war is the origin of violence within America, not even coming into our country from other countries. Now, as Donald Trump is talking about that. As we look at Donald Trump, it's still very, very early. I mean, all these candidates, probably going to be some more Republicans jump into the race. I don't know. There's a gazillion of them in there already. Opposition research is already beginning on Donald Trump because he's now shot to the front of the pack because he's talked about something that is a concern to Republican voters that they used as an issue in the last election, then immediately turned their back on it, just like they did Obamacare. But now National Review is pointing out another issue. And you know, when we look at Donald Trump, I wonder, you know, is this guy going to be a dark horse? I really think he's really more of a stalking horse. I think he's out there putting positions out there for people. It's kind of like, if you don't know what a stalking horse is, Jeremiah Johnson, at one point, he hides behind a horse so he can get up close to a bear. And the other guy that he's with, as they're hiding behind the horse to get a closer shot, the other guy says, and you're going to see how many legs we got? And the guy says, bear doesn't know how many horses, how many legs a horse has got. That's what a stalking horse is. It's using something as a shield to get in. Is he a stalking horse for the Democrats that he has given so much money to? But this is an article, even though it's opposition research, even though it's coming from National Review and the Club for Growth, and we know where these guys are coming from, it raises some very troubling issues about Donald Trump and his use of eminent domain. Do you remember Kello, the Kello decision, which said that governments can take other people's private property and give it to someone else? Donald Trump is like a character out of the Pixar movie Up, except he's the bad guy. We're going to tell you about that in the next. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host on this Wednesday, July 15th, 2015, the first day of Jade Helm. Alex Jones is going to be joining us in the studio later in the broadcast. He's working on a big story, but he will be in studio. Now, in the last segment, I was talking about Donald Trump. And as I pointed out, opposition research is already beginning on this because he's shot to first place. So National Review and Club for Growth, and we know where these guys are coming from, going to be supporting Bush, I'm sure. So they're coming out. They don't want him to get too far ahead. They don't want him to get too big. So we're already seeing some opposition research coming out. This is the way the game is played. Nevertheless, even though we know where this is coming from, even though we know they've got an agenda, listen to the information that they came out with about Donald Trump. This is something that's been around for a while, largely forgotten. They point out in the infamous 2005 Kello decision from the Supreme Court that held that public use could include, well, private use, as long as the new property owner has paid more taxes than the previous one. In other words, it allowed developers and the government to gang up on homeowners. Remember Up, the Pixar film, where you've got the older guy doesn't want to leave his home? They build, they offer him all kinds of money. They start to build the thing around his house until they can find a way to get him out. Well, the way that Trump got a widow out of his house is very interesting. And this is, I think, a very big issue. It certainly is a big issue to me. The idea that large crony capitalists, people who are well connected in government, can throw us out of our homes. This is the central issue, in my opinion, with the Keystone Pipeline. People can debate the environmentalism of it. They can debate the jobs aspect of it. Nevertheless, what concerns me about this, and I have an opinion on those things as well, but what concerns me and what is a game stopper for the Keystone Pipeline, in my opinion, is that TransCanada, a foreign corporation, multinational corporation based in Canada, has been given the right of eminent domain that they can throw people who were on their farms for over 100 years, just throw them off of their property because they're connected. This is what Donald Trump did. They say a decade and a half ago, it was fresh on everyone's mind that Donald Trump is one of the leading users of this state-sanctioned form of thievery. This is from the National Review. It was all over the news, and perhaps the most remembered example, John Stossel, got him to sputter on about how if he wasn't allowed to steal an elderly woman's house in order to expand his Atlantic City casino, the government would get less money. Now, he also had another case. It was in Bridgeport, Connecticut in 1995. He says there he was telling everybody, Trump said, we're going to have a national tourist destination by building a $350 million combined amusement park, shipping terminal, seaport village, and office complex on the east side of the harbor. The wrinkle was five businesses and the city-owned Pleasure Beach now occupy the land, he says. So what do we do? Trump says the city would become partner with Trump Connecticut Inc., and obtain the land through its powers of condemnation. Trump would buy the land from the city. That's the way the Current put it, the Connecticut Current. This is what happened. The entire development would cost the city nothing, Trump said. No private homeowners would be affected because there's no dwellings on the land. Trump would own everything. But he would throw five businesses out and take over their businesses. Why? Because he has a more important business. He's a bigger business. He can make more taxes for the city. Okay, now we get to Atlantic City with an elderly widow, Vera Coking. She had owned property near Trump Plaza Hotel for three decades, and she didn't want to move. Trump thought the land was better suited for use as a park or a parking lot or an area for waiting limousines. He tried to negotiate. At one point, he offered her $1 million for the land. She wasn't taking it. So he got the New Jersey Casino Reinvestment Development Authority to file a lawsuit, tell her she had to leave in 90 days, and he would give her $250,000, a quarter of what he had offered. She fought in court. She won. This is before Kello. But look, this is crony capitalism. This is the idea of someone who loves money. That is the root of all evil. If you define yourself, your net worth, by what you have in the bank, you're a clueless fool. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Alex Jones is going to be joining us in the studio later. He's working on a big story right now. At the bottom of the hour, we're going to have Dr. Group come in and in studio. He's going to be with us. Just want to let you know that this hour of the Alex Jones Show is made possible by your support of the high-quality products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. Products like Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. Now, X2 has over 400 reviews on InfoWarsLife.com. Over 99% of those respondents would recommend this to a friend or to a family. If you want to get a sample of some of these reviews, I've been reading these the last couple of weeks. Here's one of them. Chris Youthful at 62, he says, Discovery Bay, California. This is what he says about Survival Shield X2, Nascent Iodine. He says, I take one dropper full with 2 teaspoons of water every morning. I feel better, and my thinking processes seem to have improved. So you can check out the reviews yourself. It's what I like to do when I look at products. I like to go to Amazon.com, even if I don't buy it from them, because I try to get my products elsewhere. I try to get stuff from local retailers because I don't like to see everything being swallowed up by a few globalist corporations. If you want to support us, please turn to us for your nutrition needs. We have some fine quality products at InfoWarsLife.com, and you can see the reviews right there on the website. Again, that's InfoWarsLife.com. Now, in the last segment, for those of you that didn't hear, because I know a lot of stations carry news at the top of the hour, I was talking about opposition research that was on Donald Trump, essentially pointing out that 15 years ago, 20 years ago, he was championing the cause of confiscation of private property for big corporations. That's just where this guy is coming from. You need to understand that when somebody, the thing that's troubled me, many people keep writing me all the time, what about Donald Trump? What about Donald Trump? Look, I understand what he said about open borders. I understand the whole idea of catch and release of dangerous criminals. But like I pointed out in the last hour, let's talk about the origin of people like El Chapo, El Chompo, whatever the guy's name. I don't know. But let's talk about this little criminal who is now a multi-billionaire because of our policies, because of the war on drugs. And understand that the war on drugs is a UN agenda, just like a UN Agenda 21. The UN created it down to the four levels of drugs, four classes of drugs, the four schedules of drugs. They created that 10 years before Nixon declared war on drugs, before the federal government enacted that into law, for which they did not have legal authority, I would add. Remember that when we had alcohol prohibition, they had to add a constitutional amendment because there is nothing in the Constitution that gives the federal government the lawful authority to prohibit anything. It required a specific constitutional amendment. It took another one to overturn it. Nevertheless, when it came to the 20th century, we didn't care about the Constitution anymore, the latter part of the 20th century, I should say. We didn't care about it by mid-century. So Nixon enacted a UN agenda, and that is the source of the violent crime in our country, as well as in Mexico, as well as the violent criminals coming across. I understand the catch and release issues, but we need to get to the root issues, and we need to understand that when somebody comes to us, this is just my personal opinion on Trump, it bothers me very much when the guy announces his candidacy and his big thing is to brag about his net worth. And like I said just before we went to the break, if you think your net worth is based on the dollars in your bank account, you have a serious character problem. Serious character problem. Anyone who loves money, we have to understand that is the root of all evil. We have to understand that people who love money that much, people like John D. Rockefeller when he was asked, how much is enough? He was the richest man in the world. And the reporter asked him, how much, Mr. Rockefeller, how much money is enough? He said, just a little more. You have to understand, it is an addiction. Talk about drugs? Hey, money is an addiction too, folks. You can be addicted to it. You can be the servant of it. It can be the source of all evil. I want people in character who have character who will be the leaders of this country. I want people who understand the issues to be the leaders of this country. Not somebody like Donald Trump who would use the New Jersey casino organization to throw a little old lady out of her house because he wanted it for a parking lot. This is like something straight out of Pixar's Up. He offered $1 million. She wouldn't take it. She'd live there for 30 years. She didn't want to move. So he got the gaming authority to throw her out. Tell her she's got 90 days to go and I'll pay you a quarter of what I paid you earlier. That's the kind of guy that's proud of his negotiations. He talks like a gangster. He operates casinos. He acts like a gangster. He's a crony capitalist. I'm not interested, okay, in Donald Trump. So don't write me about Donald Trump anymore, okay? I'm done with Donald Trump, and we haven't even started the stupid presidential election. You need to understand the presidential election is just a sideshow anyway, folks. If we're ever going to change things in this country, we're going to do it at the local level. We're going to understand that we have a system of law. Part of that system of law are juries where we take it upon ourselves to watch each other's backs, to judge the law as well as the facts of the case, even though most of the judges in this country will lie to you about that. And it's even in the Constitution of many of the states, but it is part of our legal tradition. It was understood by our founders. It goes back to England. This is something that goes back a very long time, but we have such a corrupt judicial system that most of the judges will lie to you about it. They'll throw you off the jury if they know that that's what you're basing your decision on. So don't tell them. Act like the government. Keep your secret agenda. Do whatever you want to do. Don't tell them. But you sit there and you judge the facts of the case, because you know what, folks? One out of 12 persons can shut down this criminal system we've got one vote at a time. Okay? Call it the 8% solution. That's all it needs. We need 8% of the people who will stand up on principle and say, I'm going to look at this law, whether this is good or not, and I'm going to make my decision on that. We also can have state nullification. But the whole idea that we're going to get somebody elected, that we're going to send some one individual to Washington, I understand the importance of having a leader who can articulate principles. That's why I like Rand Paul. He's not perfect, okay? But he can articulate some of the things that are, there we go, right there. The 8% solution. I didn't come up with that. I thought I did. Somebody already thought of it. They put a webpage out there about that. We need somebody who's going to articulate the fundamental problems that are before our society right now. And I don't think anybody does it better than Rand Paul. And again, he's not perfect. I don't rubber stamp everything that he does, but he does it far better than anybody else that's out there. But we're not going to have a Mr. Smith go to Washington and make everything all better. It ain't going to happen. We're going to have to do it at the local level. We're going to have to do it lower down. Let me tell you something. When I was involved with the Libertarian Party, I realized that what these guys were doing, they were trying to focus everything on the highest level races. We would have to spend all of our energy just trying to get on the ballot, because, you know, the Republicans and Democrats, they always give themselves an open spot on the ballot. They're always in the debates. Of course, you had to spend so much money as an independent or a third party to get on the ballot. And then, of course, they wouldn't let you into the debates. Our ballot retention was based upon the number of votes that we got for governor or for president in North Carolina. So they deliberately skew the game to get you focused on the most difficult races to win, the most difficult place to make a change, and completely suck up all your resources. That's what the national press does to the American population. Until we focus on things at the state level, use jury nullification, use state nullification, get good people elected in state government, we're not going to see anything change. We have to start shutting down Washington, excising it out of our life like we would if it was a cancer. Let's go on to Iran. I want to talk a little bit about Iran. I don't understand fully everything that's in the deal, but let's look at what we know about it. And let's start with the two different sides, because I look at Dick Cheney, Lindsey Graham, John McCain on one side, the neocons. I look at the Obama administration on the other side. We've got Valerie Jarrett, somebody who went to Iran. Her parents took her to Iran because they hated America so much. She was born in Iran. She's an Iranian citizen. She's essentially the Henry Kissinger or Zbigniew Brzezinski of the Obama administration. She has a lot of influence and power. And so when I look at this, I look at and it's like, well, I don't get any clues as to which side to pick right there. Okay. I'm also not an Israel firster. I don't have a dog in that fight. Okay. So I'm looking at this strictly from what's happening here. And I, of course, let's let some of these people weigh in. Let's go to the clip that we've got of Dick Cheney. Let's start with that clip.
There's one interesting thing in the agreement today. This is the last sentence of the first paragraph. It says, Iran reaffirms that under no circumstances will Iran ever seek, develop, or acquire any nuclear weapons. Now, who the heck believes that? It's just beyond me to try to understand what it is Barack Obama thinks he's achieving here, why he looks at the world in,
okay,
in different light than
anybody
else.
Interesting? Dick Cheney is actually reading. He says, hey, I'm looking at this agreement. It's like, this is a guy who just, they basically just did whatever they wanted to during the Bush administration. And he said, who believes this? That's right. Dick Cheney, when Dick Cheney calls you out on credibility, you got problems, okay? This is the guy who got us involved in a war based on lies, okay? A war with Iraq. So he calls it out on lies. Let's go to the clip from Trump. Trump has a little bit different take on this.
Let's talk about the Iran deal. The president said that it's not built on trust, it's built on verification.
It's not true. It's absolutely not true.
How do you know
that? They can do whatever they want to do because I know many of the people involved in the negotiation. The Iranians are very good negotiators. The Persians are always great negotiators. They are laughing at us back in Iran. And why didn't we get our prisoners back? Why doesn't somebody say, where are our prisoners? Nobody's even talking about it. We have four people that are in prison that shouldn't be. Why couldn't they make that part of the deal?
Okay, I don't know. I didn't have time to look up what he's talking about in terms of prisoners. So, but that's a good point. Okay, but nevertheless, we see other neocon commentators like Mark Levin, and we have an article up on Infowars.com from Breitbart. Mark Levin says the Iran deal has planted the seeds for World War III. This is Munich, okay? This is appeasement. Because, you know, if you don't push for war, then you are an appeaser. That's what we're told all the time. Cheney also said, the one thing that really disturbed me was when we said that we have, quote, stopped the proliferation of nuclear weapons. That's a lie. Yeah, absolutely it is a lie. You know, we've had sanctions, and I'll talk about this when we come back. We've had sanctions against Iran since 1979. So it didn't stop them from getting as far along as they are. So I question whether or not the sanctions have been effective or not. And, of course, there were more sanctions that were put on by the Bush administration with Dick Cheney. We'll be right back. In the next segment, we're going to be joined by Dr. Group and Anthony Gucciardi from Natural Society. We're also going to open up the phone lines, and you'll be able to ask Dr. Group questions. There's a lot of news, a lot of health news that's come out, of course, as I mentioned earlier in the show, a movement in California. This is an article up on Infowars.com. California now wants to be the first state to mandate adult vaccines with criminal penalties for those who refuse. See, it never stops. You let them do that to parents, to children. They will then move to one class of adults, to another class of adults. We have absolutely no rights in that respect. We also see, and this is interesting, I think, judges are now saying that nuns must obey Obama on Obamacare. This is a story from WND. They say two judges on the 10th U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals have ruled that the Obama administration can force nuns from the Little Sisters of the Poor in Denver to pay for abortion-causing drugs. You're forcing nuns to pay for abortion-forcing drugs, okay? These are nuns we're talking about. 2-1. There you go. There's our rights just out the window, the First Amendment out the window, because we've got two judges who say so. Two judges, okay? They say, although there's an exception for churches, faith-based groups like the Little Sisters of the Poor, who run homes for needy elderly around the world, have to comply or face penalties. This is why we have the First Amendment, because the government shouldn't be sitting there deciding, okay, this church gets it, but that group doesn't because they don't have an official worship service. They just help the poor and needy. So we're going to hit them with a hammer. We're going to mandate that they buy insurance from our corporate sponsors. This is naked crony capitalism, folks, written large. This underscores that anything that the government wants to trump the First Amendment will trump the First Amendment. If they have the slightest concern in it, they'll take away your First Amendment rights. Here's what one of the nuns said. As Little Sisters of the Poor, We simply cannot choose between our care for the elderly, poor, and our faith. We should not have to make that choice because it violates our nation's commitment to ensuring that people from diverse faiths can freely follow God's calling in their lives. See, the First Amendment says that government shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech or the free exercise of religion. But of course, Congress doesn't make the laws anymore. The Supreme Court does. So the Supreme Court should be there as a check against a Congress that makes a law that violates our freedom of speech, our freedom of the free exercise of religion. But instead, they write the law. Nobody checks them. Listen, when we look at these cases like this case in California, there was just an article up from the Washington Post about how the accountant of Auschwitz has been sentenced to 4 years in prison for 300,000 deaths. This guy is in his late 90s. He was a bookkeeper who cataloged the cash and the valuables pulled from the new arrivals at Auschwitz, okay? They give him 4 years, which I guess is a life sentence when you're 96. What did he do wrong, okay? What did he do that we're not doing here? When we look at Auschwitz, besides the mass murder, when we look at the medical experimentation going on by Josef Mengele, the justification was, this is for the greater good. Yes, I'm doing horrific things to these people without their consent, but this is for the greater good. How are we any different from those people? Briefly, before we get joined by Dr. Group and Anthony Gucciardi in the next segment, I wanted to go back to Iran because I was just starting to talk about what actually happened with it. What is going to happen? What we had here was a removal of $18 billion in sanctions, okay? So they're going to get $18 billion in sanctions. Let's put that in perspective. $18 billion taken away of sanctions from Iran. We have an $18 trillion debt in this country, an $18 trillion economy, essentially. We're 1,000 times larger than they are. I don't think that this is going to make them a superpower challenge to us. We have to understand that these sanctions have been put in place since 1979. They put sanctions in place when Iran took over the embassy. They increased those sanctions in 1995. They increased them again in 2006. Did it change anything? Did it stop them from creating centrifuges or working on nuclear reactors? No. It had absolutely no effect. So to say that this is World War III, that this is Munich all over, that this is nuclear proliferation, I just don't buy it. I really don't. Why did we put the sanctions on them in 1979? Well, of course, it's because they took over the American embassy. Why did they do that? That's where our understanding of history begins, but it actually goes back to 1953. The first successful CIA coup was in Iran. They established the Shah of Iran, and the CIA put in the Savak, a brutal secret police. I learned about that when I was in high school from engineering students who were from Iran. That's what I've been concerned ever since I realized our government did it there. I realize our government can do it here. That's what I've been concerned about since then. That's my biggest concern, not what's going on in the Middle East. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and joining me now in studio is Anthony Gucciardi from Natural Society and Dr. Group. And we want to take some of your calls where you can ask Dr. Group questions. That number is going to be 800-259-9231. Again, that's 800-259-9231. That'll be questions for Dr. Group. And before we get to those calls, I just want to point out, as we're talking during the break, rather, about what's going on with Monsanto. There was an article a couple of days ago on Infowars.com. Which of your foods are sprayed with Roundup just 3 days before harvest? It's pretty much amazing. When you look at this, Anthony, it's pretty much everything that is a staple food. Wheat, corn, pretty much everything is on that list. And at the same time, we now have Monsanto pushing back against the findings from the World Health Organization that came out and said, yeah, we think glyphosate, which is Roundup, we think that it is carcinogenic, and now Monsanto is hiring a research firm to give them the results that they want.
Right, and they also bought the bee research firm after it was found out that their herbicides were killing the bees.
Yeah.
Right, so it's pretty easy to see how they work.
Well, that's global warming. There was just an article about that the other day. Forget the pesticides. It's now global warming that's killing
right,
bees.
Right, of course. Even though there's studies over and over again.
Yeah.
And this segment, I'd like to cover a few things. I'd like to cover how we actually could get a new GMO regulation plan in place, and the White House is saying they might do it. The GMO pigs that could be coming to your dinner table. Mm. How living in nature can boost your income up to $20,000, according to this study, and make you feel 7 years younger. We could talk about the Gardasil vaccine and a bunch of different stuff. But first, before I segue into Dr. Group and we start taking your calls and all that, I want to talk about a piece that's really important, and that's one that a lot of people miss, and that's called Activism Works, White House Announces New GMO Regulation Plan. I wrote this a few days ago. And what's happened now is the White House has announced in a memorandum that they say, we understand people want GMO labeling. We promise we're actually going to do something about it. Now, of course, I don't necessarily believe them, but this is good news because it shows that they're actually being forced to answer to us. Mm-hmm. And they're being forced to say, this is what they say in this memorandum, that so many people, millions of citizens have voiced concern about it, that they're looking into an independent third-party group to verify the scientific integrity and safety of GMOs and look into GMO labeling plans nationwide.
Oh, that'd be great.
But you look at the flip side of that, and there's that Monsanto Protection Act that's been reintroduced by Mike Pompeo, mm-hmm. and that would ban GMO labeling in the United States. And we're going to talk about that, too. And what
of course, you've
mean.
Also got the treaties, the Transatlantic Trans-Pacific Partnership treaties, which could make this moot. You know, it could just take this away with one stroke. So they could come out and say, yeah, you know, we did this for you guys. We heard you. We enacted this. But now we've got the treaty
right.
that takes it away.
And the bottom
line is,
you have
to be vigilant everywhere.
Yeah, you can't rely on the government. And that's why, Dr. Group, I want to segue into some of the things we can do for ourselves and also take everybody's calls. Because at the end of the day, you cannot rely on the government to protect you.
No, I mean, my solution for that is just don't purchase anything that has the toxic compounds in it and continue the activism and continue to fight against the GMOs. You know, that is good that the government is announcing that. You know, Obama came out and said that one of the things if he was elected is he was going to require GMO labeling. And you know, with March Against Monsanto, the Monsanto video revolt, we've done a lot of good. Also, I mean, now they have non-GMO verified. But like you said, I mean, who knows? There's a big fight going on right now between the government, the pharmaceutical companies, the vaccine issues, the GMO issues. My solution is just going back to nature, really, and looking and educating people and determining, let me know. I mean, is this food toxic I'm about to feed to my child or I'm about to put in my mouth? I mean, it really goes back to simplicity and the basics and things and just understanding more about your body and understanding about food and avoiding those things. I mean, now people are not buying as much chemicals. People are not, they're switching over to natural things. And as you can see with the big companies, the chemical companies, they're all racing to come out with organic products and natural products right now because of the demand out there from the general consumer. So in one area, we're making a lot of progress. And then in the other area, we're getting a lot of opposition. But I don't think the opposition is to the point where it's actually taking over the consumer. Because when it what
they
it boils down to,
this.
Yeah, the
they
consumer.
Know people. There's no question that people want. Even McDonald's is out there saying, we're going to make our stuff healthier. We're going to get rid of GMOs and everything. But in most cases, it's just a head fake. You're talking about non-GMO verified. I mean, that doesn't mean that they can't put pesticides on it. It just means that the pesticides wouldn't be GMO pesticides.
Right.
So it's a bit of a head fake from the grocery industry, just like we see that coming from McDonald's. And now this bill here might be just a head fake from the political industry. Okay. So we have to watch out for our own food.
Yeah, there are a lot of head fakes out there. Just look at the BPA baby bottle head fake. They made everybody focus on baby bottles. Yet they're still lining every single can and milk carton and everything else with BPA. So there is a lot of truth to that.
The good news is, though, that organic is booming. And Monsanto lost $100+ million in the fourth quarter last year. At McDonald's, I mix them up. They're basically the same thing. McDonald's is closing 700 stores in the United States. And they're losing so much money every month, they've stopped reporting on it. Okay, and it just goes to show the opposition against GMOs is real. The only people standing up for GMOs are the ones that are basically being paid off on it. Like Hillary Clinton says that Monsanto's GMOs are great, and obviously she's going to support them. And it goes back to not trusting things like the White House memorandum saying that they're going to look into a new GMO regulation plan. but it is a powerful message. And we do have the clip ready, I believe, where Obama promised in 2007 that he was going to label GMOs. Just so everyone's clear, this is what's going on. These are the lies that get people elected because they know the public is for this. So maybe we could play that clip.
He's going to be transparent, too.
Here's what I'll do as president. I'll immediately implement country of origin labeling because Americans should know where their food comes from. We'll let folks know whether their food has been genetically modified because Americans should know what they're buying. We'll let folks know whether their food has been genetically modified because Americans should know what they're buying.
We agree. Now is the time to label genetically modified foods because Americans have a right to know what they're buying.
And of course, he didn't keep that promise. You notice he says, immediately we'll enact GMO labeling. And everyone's like, yeah, let's do it. Yay, we love you. Wait a minute. It's 2015. That was in 2007, right?
I'm still waiting for him to be honest and transparent.
Yeah, where is it? And there's been a letter written by justlabelit.org. I think we have it over here somewhere. It basically just says, Obama, you promised to label GMOs in 2007. Everyone's seen the video. We know you said it. Where is it? Mm-hmm. And then he says, oh, well, you know, the White House, we put out this memorandum and it's we're going to work on this. No. We weren't going to work on it in 2007. We were going to do it.
Mm-hmm.
That just shows, though, the manipulation. They know what people want. 90%+ want labeling.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Yeah, I mean, and not only the GMO issue, but like you said, the glyphosate, the atrazine, I mean, all that stuff, the endocrine disrupting chemicals that are flowing off into the water supply. And that's why, you know, the earth is sick. I mean, you look around and you see all the people that are sick out there, but the earth is also sick. Trees are dying. We're losing 200 species every single day. We have the air quality is contaminated, the water, the food, everything. So, but the good news is there's solutions to that. I mean, you can clean the air quality in your home so you can breathe clean air. You can clean up the food so you can eat clean food. You can clean up and drink clean water. You can detoxify your body on a regular basis.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's the whole purpose. You have to understand how to combat the system and how look and understand what they're doing. And then at the same time, utilize technologies in your own life and your own family's life to make sure that you're avoiding all that.
Just what I was saying earlier, we have to understand what their globalist plans are, but we have to act locally, specifically for our own interests. That's what we have to do. Let's go to some of the calls. Let's go to Trish in Canada. Trish, your call for Dr. Group.
Hi there. How are you today?
Doing good. What's your question?
My question is in regards to managing chronic pain, supplements, nutritionals.
Okay, well, that's actually a pretty good question. I don't know where you're in pain, but the normal medical approach, obviously, to treating pain is with pain medications, and that ultimately doesn't address the root cause of why you're in pain to begin with. One of the things that I've used that's worked really, really good over the years is just cleansing the body. I mean, everybody has a self-healing mechanism within their bone body. I mean, we were born with it, and that's something that is not taught in any school out there. I mean, all the schools and the training that I went through, no one ever taught me about the self-healing mechanism. Just after evaluating hundreds of thousands of individuals that we've put through intestinal cleansing and liver and cleansing and chemical and heavy metal cleansing and got all of those chemicals and toxins out of their body, then and open up their elimination routes and change their diet and to where you're eating healthy, your body has the ability to heal itself of anything, whether it's pain, whether it's any type of degenerative illness. It just is crying out for you to clean it up and detoxify your body. And so what we would do for individuals with pain is start with an intestinal cleanse using the oxy powder, then go on to liver cleansing, then chemical and heavy metal cleansing and parasite cleansing. And at that point in time, if you're in pain, your liver is already seriously congested. And you've probably been on pain medications, which damage the intestinal tract and the liver, which are, by the way, two organ systems that the medical profession has tried to reduce the amount of information on and not train doctors on over the years because they know that those are the biggest secrets behind health is a healthy intestinal tract and a healthy liver. And by the way, the liver is the only organ in the body that regenerates itself and regrows fully. That's why you can do a partial liver transplant and you'll regrow it. And the intestinal cells actually turn over every 24 hours as well. So back to the pain, I suggest doing a complete body cleanse, but a couple other things that work really good, natural, oregano oil for some people has the same effects as morphine, but it's all natural and it's non-toxic and it's not an opiate, so you're not going to become addicted to it. Also, high-dose vitamin D. There was a great book written by a guy named Jeff Bowles, I think, and it was The Miraculous Healing Benefits of D3. And what he did, he had pains all over his body, joint pain. He was a martial artist, athlete. And this has been documented now. This was probably a couple years ago with hundreds upon hundreds of people and that have been taking upwards of 25,000 IUs to 50,000 IUs a day. And please consult your healthcare practitioner or your medical doctor because we're not allowed to actually give out any medical advice. But I highly recommend anybody in pain that has joint pain, joint popping, anything like that, look into reading The Miraculous Healing Benefits of mega doses or high doses of D3. And we actually have here the Winter Sun, which is a vegetarian vegan source of D3, which is a really active form. And that's one of the things that I recommend pretty much everybody take, because when we look at and do the research and trace back all these chemicals and how they affect the body and then what type of nutrients we can use and what type of things pretty much everybody's deficient in, we know now that every cell in the body has iodine receptors. We know that that was taken out of the marketplace on purpose. It's been suppressed. It's heavily regulated by the DEA. As a matter of fact, we had to go through massive interview processing just to be able to procure the deep earth iodine crystals to produce the Survival Shield X2. So also iodine works for pain, but really getting back to the basics, cleaning your body up and looking at determining the root cause and avoiding all the chemicals and toxins in your lifestyle that you have, oregano oil and D3 and iodine.
And you notice now, we can talk about this too, this headline from Nature, super muscly pigs created by small genetic tweak. And the reason I bring this up about GMO pigs is because, as you were saying, everything really comes down to cleansing the body, giving the body what it needs. And so many people, I think, are in pain because they're increasing their threshold of toxic intake on a daily basis. I mean, the new GMO creations that we face on a daily basis, the new herbicide, pesticide exposure, the radiation from Fukushima, everything is hitting us all at one time, and we're seeing an explosion of diseases across the world. And how are we supposed to deal with these things? Well, we develop products, you know, we develop supplements, we try to do healthy habits and everything like that. But at the end of the day, it's just such a load on our bodies. So I think, you know, the root cause is also the attack on our systems.
You could teach any doctor or any individual person how to pretty much eliminate any symptoms in less than about 3 or 4 hours, because it comes, and this is something that just amazed me, and I didn't learn this. It took a long time to realize, but when you think about it, it's really in simplicity, is that all it boils down to is every single person is born with a self-healing mechanism, and that's your body's own ability to heal any type of symptom. So technically, there's really not any such thing as disease out there. You know, cancer, arthritis, heart disease, whatever you have, mental illness too, whether you're suffering from depression, anxiety, it's all because your body's self-healing mechanism. All those things are just a list of symptoms and an identified disease attached to those symptoms. But when people understand how easy it is and how fast the body really wants to heal itself just by cleansing itself out, look at the earth and look at animals. You know, the earth cleanses itself as well with wind and rain and snow. I mean, now you have geoengineering actually trying to manipulate the earth and prevent cleansing of the earth, the natural cleansing of the earth, unfortunately. But it really is in simplicity, and it's amazing what happens and how fast you can regenerate the body and how fast you can eliminate symptoms just by getting on a few nutrients and paying attention and focusing on reactivating your body's self-healing mechanism.
Just making sure that your body is as healthy as possible so that it works as well as possible, really. You mentioned, Anthony, the GMO pig, I guess, makes me think about Spam, and we got somebody who wants to ask a question about school lunches. Maybe that includes the GMO pig. Sherry in Colorado, go ahead.
Hi, thank you for taking my call. I have a girl in middle school, and with everything that's going on, I'm just afraid that you know, school lunches might have a whole bunch of GMOs in them that we're not aware of.
Well, you're right. You know, anytime you assume things like that, most of the time you can feel it. And it's really sad that the majority of the schools, it's almost the worst food that you could feed to children.
You don't want to eat Michelle Obama maggot lunches? What's wrong with that? Haven't you seen the pictures? It looks delicious.
Well, you might want to eat that, but I mean, if I was in a survival state, maybe it's probably actually, eating a maggot is probably actually healthier, believe it or not, than what you're going to get in school lunches.
Look at this headline, Michelle O, lunches to expand to daycares as well.
You know, they've always been really bad. It reminds me of that old Woody Allen joke about the two ladies who go to a restaurant and the one says the food was horrible and the other one said, yeah, and in such small quantities too. I mean, that's basically what Michelle Obama has done to school lunches.
Right. I mean, my recommendation, I get that question all the time, and I know some schools are very particular, and usually what people do is they just tell the school principal or whoever they need to talk to over there that the child has allergies, and they'll allow them to bring a lunch with them. Although a lot of times they make them sit over in the corner with all the other kids with allergies. But, I mean, it is a solution to pack a good, organic, toxin-free lunch for your child and just tell them you have
allergies. Hey there, we're going to be right back. We're talking to Dr. Group, taking your calls. If you want to ask Dr. Group, the question, the number is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. Before we go back to your calls, though, this hour of the Alex Jones Show has been brought to you by the products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com, the high-quality products that we sell there. And, Anthony, we still have X2 in stock. I know it was sold out at one point in time, but I think it is still in stock. Is that correct?
That's right. And I want to have Dr. Goop explain the process of how we actually get the iodine crystals, the purple crystals, to make Survival Shield X2. But we just got an emergency supply because we were sold out for about, I believe it was a week or two last month. Now we have another emergency supply that's been in, and we are going to sell out this week. It's nerve-wracking to me because we try to forecast this, but it's very expensive to mine these crystals. It takes a lot of investment, takes a lot of time, and at the same time, we're not going to sacrifice the quality to just get more in. And I would like Dr. Group to explain a little bit about this process before we take your calls, and we're going to talk about how living in nature can help you make, according to the study, up to $20,000 extra a year and feel 7 years healthier too. But Dr. Group, let's talk about how X2 is actually created with the crystals.
Well, actually, there's been a pretty heavy demand. There's limited availability right now just because I unfortunately don't have the specific contract with the company that's mining the crystals from deep in the earth. Apparently, in Japan and all over the world, people are catching on more and more. They're seeing more health problems, especially along the coastlines. There's a higher demand practically every single month right now for iodine. And we're talking about companies. I don't know if they just want to stockpile it or what's going on, but I know that Fukushima has been releasing some reports of additional radiation, high-level radiation that's been going into the water. And I guess the high-up individuals and the high-up companies are trying to stock up as much iodine as they possibly can. They're not buying as much of the high-quality iodine. I mean, we try to get the highest quality, which is the 99.999% pure iodine crystals.
Right, and it's not from the sea, it's from the earth.
It's not from the sea, it's from the earth.
And we've been battling, and this is why I'm so passionate about it and why I want to plug it over and over again. I want to keep talking about it because the difference between us and them and the government and us, the government is stockpiling their own iodine. Remember that?
It was right.
What, 28 million doses of potassium iodine, the crap iodine. And then we're actually securing the high-quality iodine. We're trying to fight against super, super wealthy, rich business owners, super, super wealthy elite people that are stockpiling it for themselves. And we're actually trying to stockpile it for you. That's the difference.
Oh, I know. And I had actually had a big company contact me and wanted to buy the iodine crystals directly from me because it's so hard to be able to get a purchasing license for those crystals because iodine is used to create methamphetamine. And you have to go through the DEA. They do a background check on you. They do a background check on your company. You have to fill out massive amounts of paperwork. Yeah. And you have to keep the iodine crystals in a safe, like a bank safe, where only one person has a code and that individual is checked and they come out there. So they're not just handing out these licenses or this ability to buy iodine to anybody. So now I have these companies contacting me wanting to buy kilograms of the raw iodine crystals. So I mean,
and why do you think they make it so hard? Obviously, they want to stockpile it for themselves. They know the truth. They know what it's done. 10 point increase in IQ over 10 years, or was it 20 in some areas where they added iodine and reduced the fluoridation? I mean, it's obvious what's going on.
Right. It is obvious what's going on. It's why I always keep a good supply, and it's one of the most effective. I mean, if I was to choose one thing out of all the different health products out there, I mean, I would definitely have iodine, a nascent detoxified iodine like the Survival Shield X2 in my medicine cabinet.
We got one of the callers who has a question about detoxing, and we're going to come back. Stay there with us. Jerry in Florida, Janine, Matt, Denise. We'll be right back taking your calls. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host in Austin, and joining me in the studio are Anthony Gucciardi of Natural Society and Dr. Group. And we're taking your phone calls. Let's go back to one of the phone calls right now. Let's go to Jerry in Florida. Jerry, you had a question about detoxing.
Hey, guys, how's it going?
Good.
Doing good.
And listen, after the South Carolina shooting, Suboxone had really come to the forefront for opiate addictions. I live in Florida and at one point had gotten addicted to painkillers. And with all of the different forms of detoxification that it came about, whether it be methadone or cold turkey or any of that, what they had prescribed me was Suboxone, which I had done the research and found out that it was just buprenorphine with something else that's not really that great, Narcan and Naloxone. And that was, you know, pretty much it was invented for, you know, epidurals. And it was a lot of work went into it, and it was pretty safe. And then the patent ran out, so they added this other junk to it, which is designed to induce an acute detox effect if you used opiates. But is there a natural way to, you know, deal with the opiate addiction? I mean, I'm past mine now, but I still have friends that are dealing with it, and it's a gigantic problem in Florida, where you guys know that one city in Florida sold more oxycodone than, you know, the whole state of California in a year.
Wow.
There is a way. There are natural ways to deal with opiate detoxification and any type of prescription drug, you know, addiction. It's amazing how many people are addicted to pain medications or opiates. Believe it or not, gluten actually has an opiate effect. And even when you stop eating bread, you can go through withdrawal syndromes. It all boils back to the root cause again. And I associate the addiction. Everybody's different, obviously. But by cleaning up your body again, detoxifying the liver has... It's been shown that the intestinal lining with the probiotics in there, and when the probiotics are in balance, you secrete the proper neurotransmitters, almost it keeps you happy. So what happens is when the gut microflora dies off because of the poor diet and the GMOs and all the acid foods, then the liver also becomes toxic and the liver becomes fatty. When the liver is congested and fatty and the intestines aren't functioning properly, that's when you start getting a lot more depression, anxiety, and usually you can associate some sort of mental illness or mental health problem with addiction. So what I recommend doing, and this is what I recommend anybody with any type of opiate addiction is realize that you're only usually addicted because you have chemicals that are causing malfunctions in the way your neurotransmitters are in your brain. They're either blocking neurotransmitters, mercury, for example, you mix that with aluminum and it causes malfunctions. You have gluten in the food. You have artificial sweeteners, which have been proven to work as excitotoxins, artificial sweeteners, food dyes. There's a nobody knows what happens when you combine all these man-made chemicals, but we do know that they have a profound effect on the brain, on your emotions. So you can't just cold turkey those opiates, obviously, because that can throw you into a pretty hard detoxification and something you probably don't want to go through. So what we do is called time contingent detoxification. You start cleansing up your body, you start cleansing your environment, you repair the gut, you know, taking the oxy powder to clean it out and then taking a good probiotic to repair the gut and then the liver, cleansing your liver, eating healthy, and then slowly reducing your amount of medications over a period of time. And usually that is a good method that works in the majority of the time.
All right, we're going to go to break. Again, I'm talking to Dr. Group. He's taking your calls on the phone. We're going to go back to, when we come back after break, to Janine, Matt in D.C., Denise. Stay with us. We're going to be right back with Anthony Gucciardi and Dr. Group. During the break, we were talking about what real food is, and Anthony had some good comments on that. Go ahead, Anthony.
Yeah, you know, so one of the callers earlier called in, and she was wondering about some healthy lunch for her kids. And this really applies to everyone, though. So she was saying, you know, at the cafeteria, they presumably give them some pretty bad food. And the whole idea of healthy food has really changed, and I think it's important for everyone to understand that. And I call it the new health paradigm. And what that means is that an apple 50 years ago, or even 100 years ago, is no longer the apple of today.
Yeah.
Right? Because previously, you just pick an apple off a tree, put it in a basket, and give it to somebody or eat it right away. That's the apple. The apple now is the modern industrial apple. That apple is sprayed with, let's say, Roundup herbicide. Mm-hmm. It is sprayed with some type of fungicide. It is sprayed with a whole host of other different chemicals. And then there's a glaze put on it so that it retains its shine and it retains its beauty when it goes into the grocery store. And then beyond that, there could even be put some preservatives on the apple so that the grocery store has an increased profit ratio when they don't have to throw it out as quickly. So the modern day apple is much different, just as the modern day meat is much different with the hormones and the cloning technologies that's been used and been found in the food supply. So the idea of healthy has completely changed. And that is why every single thing that we look at in terms of scientific studies, I believe, will be considered to be mostly invalidated when it comes to health supplements and food over the next few decades. Specifically, that means when people do a research piece such as, oh, is vitamin E good or bad? And they don't distinguish between synthetic vitamin E, which causes birth defects, or organic food-based vitamin E, which actually helps and kills cancer cells, which is a new study that just came out 3 days ago. So we know there's a difference, and we know that, but the scientists who are quote-unquote mainstream scientists refuse to acknowledge this new health paradigm. They are in the old health paradigm where everything is exactly the same. So if they did a study, are pears good for you? They don't distinguish, is the guy buying his pear organic from Whole Foods, or is he buying it at Kmart in the discount aisle for 5 cents that has been loaded with pesticides, herbicides, and fungicides? Because I could easily do a study where I get the most garbage produce in the whole entire world and show that it causes cancer, just as you could if you wanted to do some bad things to the nutraceutical industry, as they have, take the synthetic forms of supplements and say, is vitamin E bad? It looks like it is. It looks like multivitamins are killing people. Yeah, that's because you're taking Centrum and Flintstones vitamins, which have aspartame in them, high fructose corn syrup, all synthetic vitamins, all junk, and then they're saying vitamins are bad for you. So it's a total facade, and the insiders know this. But it's important for everyone to understand this, and only when we do can we move forward. And Dr. Group, I wanted to obviously take another call, but first, a little bit of a solution thrown in here. This article is really interesting to me. This is the headline. This is a really clickbaity headline. Living near trees has health benefits worth 17,900 euros, find study, right? And the one I read said that it actually has a statistical increase in your income if you live near trees. But this one says that you could basically make an extra $20,000 a year in benefits in terms of your health, not having to spend time on your health and have better mental health and all that kind of stuff if you live near trees and have nature in your home. So simply putting a plant in your workspace can drastically change your life. I mean, these are simple things that we can do when we understand the primal aspects of our body and our biology and how to center ourselves. And personally, I always talk about if we experience nature on a daily basis, we can humble ourselves and not be so caught up in the stress and the daily, you know, craziness of our life.
So maybe money does grow on trees. Certainly it has a qualitative effect on your life, even if you can't quantify it down to a dollar and cents thing. I mean, you can actually feel it. That's a great point you were making, Anthony, about an apple is not necessarily an apple. It's not the apple that we had decades ago or a century ago, because they've been focused on marketing, on how it's presented, on shelf life. They've been selectively breeding for a long time, even before they started doing direct genetic modification to make sure that it doesn't turn brown when you cut it. I mean, so it's a completely different, different thing.
I'll tell you a strange story, but it works. Is somebody told me a long time ago before I had kids that what they were doing for discipline for their kids, would they would walk them out and have them hug a tree whenever they got upset about something or they got angry about anything, or have them, you know, they also had a little meditation chair. And I tell you what, I tried it and it actually works. You know, when my kids get upset about something or get angry, I have two boys and they're at the age where they're bickering back and forth. And I'll just say, you need to release your emotions. You have some emotions inside. You need to get out. Come walk with me. And we'll walk over there and we have a tree and they'll hug the tree. And within, I could literally count to 30 seconds and they're completely calm. I mean, that's not new. Look at nature healing people for thousands and thousands of years. I mean, it's everybody feels good when they're in nature. Mm-hmm. That's another reason why I recommend everybody put plants in their house, you know, two or three plants in every room of their house, because what do plants do? They increase the oxygen content. Mm-hmm. They suck up the CO2 in the air. They also take all a lot of the chemicals out of the air. So plants will actually clean your air for you in your home. So
very important. Let's go to some of the callers. We have a question about diet from Matt in DC. Matt, go ahead.
Hi, thanks for taking my call. First, actually, I wanted to comment on this previous caller about the opiate withdrawal. Massage therapy actually can do a lot for people going through withdrawal. But my main question goes to I was curious about Dr. Group's diet, what he eats and how he feels about the vegan diet for psychological and health benefits.
Well, thanks, Matt. Diet is one of the things that I think everybody individually needs to look at depending on. That's why I don't think there's one diet that's good for everybody, because if you look back in history, it's really when people used to grow their own food, it was what would grow on my land? What can I grow on my land that I can eat? So really, the perfect diet would be a diet that is indigenous to the area that you live in. I've been experimenting with diets and with my diet for a long time. I used to eat meat. I was having digestive problems. I got off of meat. Those went away, but I'm an O blood type. I cold turkeyed the meat. And then after about a month, I was feeling weak, fatigued. I mean, I could barely get out of bed. So I had to slowly introduce it back into my diet. Then over a period of time, I slowly got off of meat. Now, I do believe you need protein, and that's a whole nother subject right there. But believe it or not, what we're dealing with today, which is one of the main problems with diet, I'm pretty much 80% raw food. I eat pretty much 80% raw food, usually around 90% raw and 10% cooked, and mostly I haven't eaten meat in years. But what I'm learning is the body, there's carbohydrates, fats, and proteins. You need the proteins and the fats, but you really don't even need the carbohydrates that much. That's why Atkins' program was so effective with the low carbohydrate. I don't necessarily agree with that, but I like a vegetable-based diet, fruit-based diet, and a nut and seed-based diet is what seems to work the best for most people. But I also think each individual person should customize their diet and pay attention to their body, because I also think that everybody has certain genetic codes that, you know, certain foods may cause them allergies. A lot of people, you know, react to potatoes. Some people are going to react to corn. I mean, different things. So everybody's diet should be kind of customized. Really, each individual should pay attention to how food makes them feel and see what foods are going to work the best in their body.
That's great. Let's go to Juan in New Jersey. Kind of a related question, I guess, inflammatory bowel disease. Go ahead, Juan.
Yes, how you doing? Good afternoon, gentlemen. My question for Dr. Group is, I'm currently taking a Prezo, and from the time when I have flare-ups, I wind up, doctor prescribes me a prednisone, which is horrible. And I just want to know, what is your take on substituting that for organic slippery elm bark powder?
Okay, well, we did a lot of research. That's actually one of our specialties is bowel disease and the different causes of bowel disease, because that's really the root cause of all disease, right? I mean, all disease-causing toxins enter through the bowel to begin with. So we looked at, first thing you need to look at is what is causing the problem? Why do you have inflammatory bowel disease? Because you don't really want to say, okay, what can I do to replace this? I mean, and even in naturopathic schools and all the herbal medicine schools, they still teach how to treat the symptoms and not how to treat the root cause. What I want like to teach people, because the true definition of a doctor, right, is a teacher, not a prescriber, whether it's natural or not. there are certain things we talk about here that I think everybody needs and everybody should do on a regular basis that we're just not getting in the food supply.
I was wondering if he's on gluten. Are you eating gluten, Juan?
Any type of wheat products?
So there's your issue right there. I mean, personally,
that's the root cause. What I'm talking about.
So exactly. I wouldn't even get into the world of supplements until you address the intake first and foremost, right? Because I mean, if you have, for example, we know that McDonald's can kill the good bacteria in your gut for up to 2 to 3 weeks or permanently. Okay. So if you're eating McDonald's for a week, let's say, it can devastate the gut bacteria in a way that you may never replenish naturally in your life without taking a probiotic. So if you're eating, as you say, everything under the sun, which is fine, but it's time to change that because you have inflammatory bowel disease. And I've suffered with stuff like gastritis and IBS in the past. And for me, the number one thing is gluten, because what happens is you've destroyed your gut so much basically that it's now ripping at it at a micro level and entering all the toxic stuff that you eat through the gut lining. So you need, I mean, not to interrupt with you because you're getting onto it, but I could just tell. But a lot of people, they say like, well, I want to take, you know, Slippery Elm or whatever. I want to take this and this. But you first have to address what's going in. Does that make sense, Juan?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean,
let me just add one more thing to that. What you have, Slippery Elm, Cascara Sagrada, Senna, Marshmallow Root, all of those mucus-forming herbs can be used temporarily in the gut, but over a long period of time, they don't address the root cause of the problem. Oxy powder, by the way, has gone through phase 1, 2, and 3 clinical trials specifically for irritable bowel, IBS, and I suggest that you clean it out with oxygen.
We're going to be right back. Hang on, we got to go to a break. We're going to be right back with more of your calls for Dr. Group. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and I'm joined in this segment by Anthony Gucciardi and Dr. Group. We're going to be taking in this last segment that we have with them more of your calls and questions, health questions. Of course, this hour of the Alex Jones Show is brought to you by the products that we sell at InfoWarsLife.com. Anthony, we were talking about X2, Survival Shield, Nascent Iodine. That is back in stock. We also have back in stock Super Male.
Yes, we do. And again, X2, we're going to sell out this week. So if you want some, get some now. And, you know, unfortunately, it looks like Super Male is going to be along those lines too at current rates. And the reason I wanted to bring that one up specifically for the segment is because I was talking to Dr. Group in the break, and I'm familiar with how it works and I know about the different herbs and everything like that, but I'm just continually impressed over and over again when I take it. And I'll admit I'm a little afraid to take it sometimes. I try to take it every day. I put it in my protein shake. Sometimes I want to take more, but I'm a little afraid because I'm already a driven person and I'll already stay up till 3 a.m. working. I will do it. I mean, yeah. I've done it routinely over and over again. Sometimes I stay up till like 6 a.m. I actually like working overnight sometimes. Anyway, I'm afraid to take Super Male Vitality sometimes because I don't want to stay up till 4 a.m. Not that it even gives me, it's not just the energy. It's not like it's going to keep me up all night. It makes me driven. It makes me want to do crazy, like amazing things. Like it makes me think, well, gee, I just gave this much to a charity. I want to give 50 times that next month. And it just sets these goals in my brain that are just so crazy. And I know many people are super happy with that. And I'm happy with it too. But what is it that literally just drives me when I take that?
Do you remember when you were 16 and you wanted to stay up all night and you could stay up all night?
I still do, actually.
And, you know, you would feel great the next morning. That's because all your hormones were in sync. You had high testosterone, you had high DHEA, you had growth hormone kicking through your body. And all the functions in the body have to deal with hormones. And that's any male, for that matter, and women are having hormone problems too. We've talked about it a lot. All the endocrine disrupting chemicals right now that are everywhere in the world, in the water, in the, you know, food supply, the phthalates, which are endocrine disrupting chemicals. I mean, we all have hormone problems and hormone depletions and hormone imbalance. That's why the medical community is trying to make so much money right now on hormone replacement therapy, because they see it's happening. Well, it's the old, let's cause the problem so we can make money trying to fix the problem. But they're not fixing it. All they're doing is injecting more hormones into people. So Super Male Vitality, you said about an apple, right? That you might have one apple, two apples next to each other. One apple is organic, super nutritious. The other apple, you can't see the thousands of chemicals and toxins and fungicides and everything on it. Well, if you look at both of them, you're not really going to know, right, until you analyze them. It's the same thing with herbs. It's called choosing your herbs with the highest therapeutic value. So if you look at maca root, for example, which is one of the main ingredients in Super Male Vitality, There's 1,000 different suppliers for maca root. If you take all of those suppliers and run analysis on all of the maca root, because you're looking for the active therapeutic compounds, the ones that are actually going to work the best and have the strongest amount of the phytochemicals in them. I can tell you that evaluating herbs for years and years and years, there's very, very, very few companies. A lot of the herbs come from China, India. They sit in warehouses in 120, 130 degrees. They're already powdered, which means they lose the therapeutic and phyto essential oils, get oxidized off of them. What we try to do is go directly to the farm, find out the highest quality, the highest potency levels, get those herbs cut and sifted, which means the plant is pretty much in its whole state. Then we grind it and put it immediately into the high technology proprietary process with vegetable glycerin that we use to preserve and encapsulate the high quality compounds in those. And we do that with multiple herbs that are in Super Male Vitality, Super Female Vitality, all the products that InfoWars Life sells. So that's the difference between what we have here and all the other people out there. And that's what makes Super Male Vitality so successful, because any male over the age of 28, and I'm not just making this up, you can look at any scientific research behind this, our hormones start declining at age 28. Our DHEA, our testosterone, our growth hormone just keep going down, 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 down with age. That's why we start developing more body fat at the age of 28, and the liver becomes congested again. And that's why I believe every male should be supplementing with some sort of hormone. It's not actually a hormone, by the way. It just helps your body balance and secrete those hormones naturally.
Let's go to, we don't have too much time. Very quickly, let's go to Janine in Minnesota. You had a question about liver cleansing. Janine, go ahead.
Yes, I do. And it is a quick question. It's not only for me. I've had many discussions with other people that are in the same boat. We want to do the liver cleanse, but we have had our gallbladders surgically removed. We want to know if it's safe to do it just as written.
10 seconds.
Yes, Janine, we only have 10 seconds left, but it's actually even more necessary to do it if you don't have your gallbladder, because the liver has to take over for the gallbladder. So it's a good question. Anybody who has their gallbladder out should be doing more liver cleanses. Thank you.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I am David Knight, your host. We're going to take some of your calls, and I apologize to the people that have been on hold to talk to Dr. Group with health questions. We're going to purge those phone lines. Sorry, folks, those of you who have held on. I want to give that number out again to people who want to call and talk about some of the other topics that we talked about earlier, about the Iran deal, about the Planned Parenthood video, perhaps about Jade Helm. There's some other news items that I want to cover as well. Let me give you that number, 800-259-9231. Again, that's 800-259-9231 if you'd like to talk about those topics. Of course, this was some information that we had about a week or so ago, where the Office of Personnel Management for the Federal Government, OPM, announced that more than 21 million people had been affected by a data breach. And this was a second data breach at that point in time. 21 million Social Security numbers were compromised in this hack. They say the hack is separate from the breach of OPM data that compromised 4.2 million Social Security number. So that was a couple of weeks before. So in the last couple of weeks, we've lost first 4.2 million Social Security numbers, then 21 million Social Security numbers. Now, a week later, what have we lost? Over a million fingerprints. OPM announced last week that the personal data for 21.5 million people, of course, have been stolen, but now it's 1.1 million fingerprints. Can you trust the government? Can you trust them to keep any of this information private? As we get all this stuff, all the biometrics on us, of course, we're very concerned about how the government is data mining things, but also in terms of how they cannot even protect it from criminals or foreign governments who would hack into it. And of course, many of the people who have had this stolen, of course, they're federal employees, people who had trusted the government to watch their data. No, they're not doing a very good job of that, but they also are joining with hackers. This is something we learned from WikiLeaks. They say, this is an article from the New American. They say, what does an Italian software company and Orlando law enforcement have in common? Well, This is the company Hacking Team. They say the Italian company that sells surveillance software to government and law enforcement agencies worldwide is now selling information and software to Orlando police departments. They've been working with some of the worst abusers of human rights, and I guess we'd have to put the United States government in that category as well, since they do look at everybody in the world's information and try to store it. They said they also found, in terms of looking at the investigations, they found emails from Orlando's from Orlando, Florida. Law enforcement, the police department there said that they would like to speak to someone regarding their products to intercept people's emails and spy on them. It's not even news anymore that our government is spying on us in every single way, tapping everything that we do, listening to us on the phone. And of course, what this software does is it monitors email conversations. It can turn your phone or your laptop on and send it back to the surveillance company. Again, that's why I say, when we talk about the rhetoric that's been used over the years, where, remember, Roe v. Wade was, we were told that the Supreme Court had discovered in the Constitution a right to privacy. They seem to have lost our rights to due process. They seem to have lost our rights to our Fourth Amendment protections, to have a search warrant taken out if they want to search somebody's homes. How absurd that they would sell this as a right to privacy when they spy on everything, everything that we do. Briefly, before I go back to your phone calls, another couple of articles that are up. Murder rates, we see, this is good news, drop as concealed carry permits are soaring. And of course, we've just had yet another state come in and legalize constitutional carry, which means that you don't have to get permission from the government to exercise your God-given, constitutionally recognized right to protect yourself, to keep and to bear arms, not to just keep them locked up in a gun chest back at your house. And then another, before I go to your calls, one last story here, a strange story that went up last night. It's from Kit Daniels. It's on Infowars.com. Gay man sues Bible publishers over homosexuality is a sin versus in the Bible. Now, this is a gay man has filed a $70 million lawsuit against two publishers of Bibles, claiming that their translation of the Bible, calling homosexuality a sin, caused him emotional distress. And of course, those publishers are Zondervan, one of the largest Christian book publishers. And let's see, I don't see the other one on here, but it's listed in the article if you want to see that. And they point out that the gay activists have written their own Bible. They call it the Queen James Version. Well, you know, if he's concerned about the particular passages that he's quoting, I just have to say, wait until he gets to the part about Sodom and Gomorrah. He's not going to like that at all. And that's not to pour anything, condemnation on homosexuals, okay? You need to understand, and homosexuals need to understand, why this is such a big issue to Christians. Every sin is rebellion against God. That's what we understand. And so we don't want to be involved in participating in the celebration of something that we see as rebellion to God. And to all the Christians out there who are saying, yeah, yeah, wait till they get to Sodom and Gomorrah, I just want to say that there aren't any of us that don't have our own pet sins. And no sin, no matter how small you think it is rebellion to God. That's why we all need a Savior. It isn't something that, you know, you got somebody that's going to come to you and tell you that, hey, you know, yeah, I don't do this, I don't do that, and I try to be as good as I can, and I think I'm doing pretty good, and God's just going to take the rest of it. It's like, no, you don't understand the true nature of sin. You don't understand that it is, any sin is cosmic rebellion to God. And no matter how small or how large that sin is, you still need Christ, and you still need the Bible to tell you about it. But that's where we're headed. This kind of absurd claim where we're going back and forth. And I just wish people would understand that I think we need to get the government out of these areas of our life. And I see Christians on the other side making demands, saying that we have to make sure that the government doesn't take away contracts from different organizations because they do this or they don't do that because of their position on homosexual marriage. It's like, get yourself weaned off of a government that tries to bribe you with your own money. That is what is fundamentally behind this whole thing about homosexual marriage, I believe. Anyway, they've had the ability, people have had, whether they're, if they're homosexual, they had the ability to have their own relationships. Nobody is throwing them in jail like we did 150 years ago in England with the guy that, Oscar Wilde, was jailed because of that. Nobody is having that done, but they're looking to get subsidy to get official government recognition, and so are the Christians. And I say to both sides, let's forget about official government recognition. Let's make our own relationships. Let's work together on voluntary contracts. We can do that. We can set up our own wills, living wills. When we have a loved one that is in the hospital, we can do that. We can work for employers that appreciate us, that want to have us as employees, that will voluntarily give us the kind of benefits that we want. We don't have to use government to hold a gun to somebody's head and make it happen. And that's true for Christians as well as it is for people who want homosexual marriage. I think that's where we need to go with this. That's something that was mentioned by David Simpson here in Texas. I think that's the right approach to take. Again, before I go to your calls, I just want to talk a little bit more about this Iranian thing. When I look at this, and I look at the $18 billion in sanctions, because that's basically what we have presented on our side, in exchange for that, we're supposedly going to get more access to look to see what they're doing with nuclear weapons. I don't see it as a prelude to World War III, unless someone on the other side wants to start it. Certainly, we are taking sides in the Middle East. We need to understand that the Middle East is not monolithic. The Arabs, the Muslims are divided into different groups. We need to understand that. There's Sunnis in Iraq. Also, ISIS are Sunni, okay? The Iranians are Shia, different kind of Islam. And, of course, the Saudis are Wahhabis. And I have to ask, why are we allying ourselves with the Saudis, the most brutal regime of any of them? And, of course, they're all jockeying for position, all trying to get ally themselves with the United States, with each other for a leveraging situation. But we got Saudi Arabia, which beheads more people than ISIS, and that is our closest ally embedded inside of the CIA. Why is that the case? Why are the Saudis our closest allies? Certainly, Iran has done some things that we're concerned about, but we've done things to Iran that people should be concerned about. We shot down a commercial airliner. Did they do anything after that? No. If that had happened the other way around, it would have been instant war. So hopefully this is going to be something that will de-escalate the situation. We know that North Korea has a nuclear bomb. I'm not happy with a lot of countries having the nuclear bomb. I wish we didn't have it here right now. Frankly, I wish we didn't have nuclear power plants. I'm very concerned about how we dispose of nuclear waste, the long-term issues of that. Nevertheless, I don't think it is the end of the world. We have attacked this in other ways, trying to keep them from getting the bomb. Of course, that's what the Stuxnet virus was all about, infecting their computers. The thing that I thought was interesting was a celebration of the Iranian people saying, well, you know, this is great. Now we can get things like iPhones. I mean, they're not that different from us folks. And perhaps that's going to be the way that the CIA stops them from getting the bomb. Once they get iPhones in the hands of everybody in Iran, I guess it's game over for them, pretty much the way that it is for us as well. Let's go to your calls. Let's go to Gail in Ohio. Go ahead, Gail.
Hi.
You said you want to talk about the military. Go ahead.
Yes. I come from a small town in Maine, a very small town. It's called Hudson, Maine. Probably can't even find it on the map. It's about 25 miles north of Bangor, Maine. Today, talking to my aunt on the phone, she said, there's something going on, and I'm not sure what it is, but there is a whole bunch of military next door to her at the fire station, and they're all dressed in khaki colors carrying guns. She got a guy came to her door this morning and said, don't worry, about 2 o'clock, if you hear a bunch of gunfire, it's not real bullets. We're just practicing. She called it a reenactment. But she wasn't really sure what is going on. But I mean, this is a little tiny town. Almost everybody there doesn't have a landline, so I don't have cell phone numbers of anybody up there.
I think it's interesting when you bring this up, because we're getting so many reports from so many different places, people seeing massive amounts of military equipment? Is it heightened because people are concerned about Jade Helm, or is it something that we're seeing the military do more of? And of course, right now, people are looking at this and questioning it because it's something that they haven't seen before. That's a big part of what all of these exercises are about. They're about getting us accustomed to see the military on the streets all the time. That is a precursor to them taking a much more active role in law enforcement, essentially paving the way, if they want to, for enacting martial law at some point down the future, very covertly, because people will have their guard down because they've seen so much movement of military and equipment and they have become accustomed to it. I frankly don't want to live in a banana republic with nuclear weapons. And that's what this country is turning into rapidly when we look at the continuous surveillance. As I pointed out before, that's one of the things that concerns me most about Jade Helm, is the fact that you've got Special Forces, Admiral McRaven, selling himself to the NSA, saying we'll be the boots on the ground, the human intelligence for the NSA and data collection. Thank you so much for that. Let's go to Eric in New York. Eric, you had a comment about the military.
Good afternoon, David.
Hi. Go ahead.
As you know, the U.S. military are treated like guinea pigs anyway with the vaccinations and they breathe depleted uranium. Do you believe that this is some sort of a future plan for AI intelligence and autonomous drones and whatnot?
Oh, absolutely. And if you haven't seen it, I would suggest you go back and look. It was a couple of months ago. Rob Dew and I did a long report here in the studio about Jade Helm, about mastering the human domain, about geospatial intelligence, human domain analytics, activity-based intelligence. We break down all those Pentagon terms for you, all those acronyms. We talk about what our concerns are for where this is going. And you need to understand, as I think you do, based on your question, that it's not going to be that far in the future that when they're going to have autonomous killing machines. They're gradually pulling this back. They still have human operators that are making decisions from a distance. That is troubling, but it's going to be even more troubling when they bring in autonomous killing machines. And this is not something we're making up. This is not science fiction. These are DARPA projects. You can read about it. There are multiple DARPA and Pentagon projects working on autonomous killing machines. We've talked to Noel Starkey from the UK. We've got people in a lot of different countries that are coming together trying to make sure that we get some kind of a prohibition against this. I don't know if that's going to work or not. We've had prohibitions against other types of warfare that basically have not been good. This is something that is coming up in the future, though. They're not going to need veterans. And of course, when people look at the way the veterans have been treated in the hospitals, that's something you need to look at closely and understand the difference between the promise of health insurance, which is what the VA is, and the provision of health care. There's a big gap there. And we need to keep that in mind when we look at Obamacare as well, because again, that is something where we're being required to buy health insurance. Health insurance doesn't mean that you're going to get health care. I know many cases personally of people who had health care all their life, and then the health insurance company found a way to dump them when they found out that they had terminal cancer. I know many cases of that. And of course, that's essentially, Eric, what we're seeing in the VA, isn't it?
Yes, we are. And I think it's a frightening future that humanity faces. And when you realize that, nothing else really matters with the baseball game. You know, you got to care about your family. I'm not really a religious person, but I think that there is a supreme being. And I think the educated people from poor backgrounds, the upper class, the middle class, have to discuss this because, as you said, Dave, we're heading towards a future where the elite think that biological evolution won't be needed. They're called transhumanism, as and Alex has pointed out. And that's a scary, that's their endgame. And I always keep that in mind when I think of Iran, anti-gay marriage and whatnot. I think overall the final issue is their final solution. I mean, they're just Hitler.
That's where all this tyranny's final step is a massive eugenics program. That's where it ultimately leads. Thank you, Eric. And you said that you're not a religious person. I am a religious person. I would say the people who are not religious, I would say to them that you need to understand that if people don't recognize your leaders and the elites who are running the world here, if they don't recognize a God, They see themselves as God. That is one of the most dangerous things that we could have, that the technological elite, that our political elite would see themselves as God. That's why in the Declaration of Independence, they appeal to the Creator as the source of our human rights, not given to us by the government. So understand that, even if you don't believe in God, understand you don't want men who think they are God. Stay with us. We'll be right back with more of your calls. I want to go right back to your calls. Let's go to Brad in Louisiana. You wanted to talk about scientists. Go ahead.
Hi, yes, Dave. I, like yourself, am a religious man. I believe that there's nothing new under the sun. And the proof positive of that in my heart is that these scientists, I hear you and Alex expounding on the facts, not making things up, but expounding on fact. And all these guys are doing is what men's minds in books that have been written in the past. They're just making those books come to become reality.
Yeah.
And in fact, you know, I believe that when faced with an immoral situation, we must obey God rather than man. And so I say that there's nothing new that's going on, which is why astute individuals like yourself, like Alex, like several others, George Norrie, many of your guests, we all see this as just a repetition, and that's what making the predictions of what is to follow so easy, because man is following man and stupidly carrying out that agenda. I don't know. Do you believe that way?
Oh, absolutely. I think it's very dangerous, as I talked about last week. You know, anybody that's seen Jurassic Park, you know, the underlying theme of that, people remember if they've seen the movie, not even read the book, they remember the underlying theme is the character played by Jeff Goldblum, who says, just because you can build it doesn't mean that you should build it. They have completely divorced technology from any kind of ethical understanding. And, of course, you know, they think that they're going to achieve eternal life. They think they're going to achieve power over other people through the technology. But many of the scientists are not even thinking about that aspect. They're just narrowly focusing on the problem. Michael Crichton called it in the book, the original book, Jurassic Park, he called it thin intelligence. He said they see very narrowly. They don't see what's surrounding it. They don't understand the context. They don't see the consequences. We need, as scientists, to start thinking about the consequences of what we're doing. And if they won't do it, the rest of us need to make sure that we stop that. I know Hugo de Garras thinks that's going to result in the Ardalic Wars. We have an intellectual elite who, once the populace starts to realize, and of course, realize it a bit too late. That's what we want to make sure doesn't happen, that people don't realize it too late to do something about it. But he says once they realize it'll be too late, the intellectual elite will go their own way. There will be a massive war with gigadeath. Well, let me tell you what. With these technologies, if they're not kept under control, there will be gigadeath. We've got the government bringing in deadly bacteria that are not indigenous to our area, creating gain-of-function experiments, trying to make them more lethal, trying to make them more easily transmitted. They call them select agents. That's the CDC's term for it. I mean, that's absolute insanity. You want to get concerned about nuclear weapons in Iran? Get concerned about what your government is doing in your own backyard. We've got 200 level 3, level 4 biosafety labs in the United States. Over 100 of them have had leaks, have had problems. That's a greater existential threat to the United States than some third world country on the other side of the world. You need to understand what your own government is doing through DARPA, through these other experiments, and do something about that. Thank you, Brad in L.A. Let's go to Rich in New York. Rich?
Yeah, how you doing, Dave?
Doing good.
Listen, don't you think that the problem with immigration and also the cartels is an easy one to solve? I mean, we're always sticking our nose in somewhere. How about fixing Mexico? Because I talked to plenty of Mexicans, and they don't want to be Americans. They want to be Mexican. They can't be Mexican because they can't work there, so they come here.
Yeah. Well, that's just it. They don't want that to happen. They want to keep the borders open because they want to get everybody in one spot. They want to... It's a Cloward and Piven strategy. They want to overwhelm the United States with a population that they can control, divide and conquer, as well as economically through the welfare system. That's what I believe. Stay with us. We're going to take some more of your calls right after the break. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this one segment of Overdrive. We're going to try to get to some of your calls. Some of the people have been holding for a while. I wanted to give them a chance to ask their questions. And we have a question and answer session going on right now on our main Facebook page. That's Alexander Emmerich Jones. If you go there, You can leave some questions. They will be answered on tonight's Nightly News at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern. Let's go to Zen Girl. You have a question or a comment about Jade Helm. Go ahead, Zen Girl. Go ahead, Zen Girl in Florida. Go ahead. Okay, let's go to HB and FEMA 4. You had a comment.
Great show, David Knight. Great show.
Thank you.
Joyce Riley had posed a question yesterday morning on her show. Who gives the United States the right to say who can have nuclear weapons and who can't?
That's right.
I'll get off here and let you talk about it.
Well, that's right. And I think if we, we haven't effectively been able to stop North Korea, but that is a good point. When we go back and we look at this, just remember the Vietnam War. Remember, we saw Southeast Asia monolithically. Everybody was Asian. And because the Vietnamese were Asian, like the Chinese, we believed that the Vietnamese were going to become come within the influence of the Chinese. It's very important to go back and look at a documentary called The Fog of War. It's a great documentary from one of the, I think his name is Errol Morris, a great documentarian. In that, you have Robert McNamara at the end of his life making a confession, I think, about where he went wrong, talking about how years later he went back to Vietnam and met with former leaders of Vietnam, and the guy angrily pounded the table and said, "Why did you do this? Why did you come up with this idiotic strategy of a domino theory? Don't you know anything about history? Don't you know about our history? Don't you understand that for thousands of years, we've been fighting the Chinese for our independence?" And of course, we see that that is going on to this day. We now have the Chinese government is trying to encroach in Vietnamese territory with islands and other things that they're doing. They're still fighting them. The domino theory was nonsense. The domino theory didn't stop anything. It didn't change anything when we lost Vietnam. I don't think that the situation that's going on in the Middle East is going to change anything. As I pointed out before, we've got three different groups there. We've got the Sunnis, the Shias, the Wahhabis. We ally ourselves with the most radical, the most violent regime there. If you believe the government's official story of 9/11, then we're aligning ourselves with the people who follow the sect of Islam that took down the World Trade Center, if that's what you believe. Okay, so why is that happening? Why is it that we're doing it with those people? It makes absolutely no sense to me. I don't think that removing $18 billion worth of sanctions from Iran is going to really substantially change the world. I really don't. And if you're concerned about nuclear proliferation, what are they doing about North Korea? I don't understand that either. Let's go to... thank you for your comments, HB. Let's go to John in California. I want to try to move quickly. Go ahead, John.
Well, hi, Alex. How are you doing today?
I'm doing good. I'm David, though.
Okay. Okay. You know, what I want to talk about was looking at all of this information. If you, our minds are like a calculator. You put in this information from this part of the world, this information from this part of the world, this or multiple informations just from this one country. And you press the equal button, you don't really get a direct answer. And I think the problem is nobody knows what's coming. I don't know where our world is headed, but I think there's a handbasket involved.
That's true. That's true. That's why we need to keep our eyes open for Jade Helm. Yeah, thank you so much. I will move quickly to some other people with comments. Let's go to Rick in New Jersey. Rick, go ahead.
Hey,
Rick, are you there?
Buddy. Listen, only one thing. I hear all this rhetoric from all the candidates and everything, and I just don't know why. How come they're always talking about reinstating Glass-Steagall? I mean, I'm no great money guy, but wouldn't that put the derivatives and everything, all the debt back on Wall Street?
Well, you're assuming that they don't want the kind of shenanigans that have been going on. I mean, it's not even just Glass-Steagall. When we had the Dodd-Frank reform bill, that was basically an open... case for the banks to continue this type of thing. And now we have what they allowed them to do was to put draconian requirements on everybody in terms of if you're having a hard time getting a home loan, you can thank that quote-unquote reform bill, but it has done nothing to stop the speculation. That's it for today's broadcast. Join us tonight at 7 Central.